Hello and a very warm welcome to Insight. I'm Amandra Bhatt. The NDA government under Prime Minister Narendra Modi is completing 1 year in office tomorrow. One area which has been seen as the greatest successes of his prime ministership is his foreign visits. Visiting 18 countries in a span of 1 year, the prime minister has crisscrossed the world, striking a rapport with world leaders, wooing investors and making a pitch for the Make in India mantra, bringing his own style to India's global connect. However, his critics argue that these trips have had no use for foreign policy or for foreign trade. The government argues that the Prime Minister's foreign trips have elevated India's status on the world stage and have successfully changed the perception about India. Today in Insight, we discuss the Prime Minister's international visits in the last 1 year. And to discuss the same, we are joined in our studios by two distinguished guests. Please welcome Seshadri Chari. He's a noted foreign policy and strategic affairs analyst, also a member of the BJP's national executive. Welcome to the show, Mr. Chari. We are also joined by Vijay Kranti. He's a well-known columnist and a senior journalist. Welcome to the show, Mr. Kranti. Later in the program, we'll be joined by Professor Makhanlal from the Vivekananda International Foundation. And we are hoping to connect to Professor Gopal Arora, who is the Secretary of Indian Council for International Cooperation as well. Mr. Chari, I'd like to begin with you. You know, the opposition has been targeting the Prime Minister for his many foreign trips overseas, almost using it, you know, like a tool in their press conferences and so on. Do you think they have somewhat succeeded in their strategy? And why so much of noise is being raised about the Prime Minister's visits abroad?
No, you know, it would be wrong to say that the opposition is targeting the Prime Minister. In general, there are a few individuals who are opposed to this government for political reasons. Mm-hmm. And it is only their selective lone voice. Otherwise, in general, if you see, there is consensus among all political parties. Mm-hmm. And also people who would generally not agree with the BJP's point of view or the BJP's worldview, even they are of the opinion that the overwhelming support that India has received in the last 1 year in the world community has increased. See, you have to always compare the present situation with what was existing 1 year before. Mm-hmm. For various reasons, we would not go into those details why it happened. But in general, the world community had flagged us down. Some people even went to the extent of saying that there is a policy paralysis, no investment was happening. For the last 10 years, our investments were absolutely zero or nil. Even countries which would otherwise be on our side on every issue, say Maldives or even Bhutan, had turned hostile towards us. Never in the history had a country like Bhutan turned hostile towards us. We can understand Pakistan, we can understand some other countries. The situation is in Afghanistan was turning very bad for us. The US was unable to reach out to us and we made no efforts to do that. The situation in West Asia was changing and we had absolutely no control over the situation there. Mm-hmm. We were unable to manage the balance between US and China. Japan had practically written us off. And our forays into African region was practically zero, which means we had actually given access to China, not only in Africa, but also in the Indian Ocean region of all the things.
Right.
So if you look at the entire gamut of this foreign policy 1 year back, we were in a very bad shape. But it was Prime Minister Narendra Modi. The fact was people did not expect Prime Minister Narendra Modi to be a very proactive foreign policy practitioner. He was considered to be good at internal politics and other things.
Right.
But his very first step of inviting SAARC leaders and regional leaders for the swearing-in ceremony sent a very good signal. Mm-hmm. So beginning from that and now the forthcoming Bangladesh visit. If you look at all these visits, every visit has taken India a few notches above in the recognition, international recognition that we were seeking. So this was a there was a need for hard selling a soft power. India is a soft power, considered to be a soft power, and we take pride in being a soft power.
Right.
So we don't want to flex our military muscles. We want to use diplomacy and culture and our own traditional way of dealing with countries as the backbone of our foreign policy. So usually what we always say is foreign policies don't change with change of government. Major changes don't occur. Of course, there has to be a course correction which has been done in the last 1 year. Moreover, you cannot have a set foreign policy for the next 5 years, like the five-year plan or the agriculture plan or the education plan. You cannot have a five-year foreign policy because foreign policies have to be naturally corrected and correlated to the happenings elsewhere.
Right.
Something happens in the US, something happens in China, something happens in Afghanistan, something happens in West Asia, and you have to refurbish your foreign policy to suit the situation.
Right. And also each leader has his or her own style, their own contribution to the foreign policy.
So if you look at all these things, I think the Prime Minister's foreign visits have moved India, catapulted India to the center stage of world politics.
Okay. Vijay Kranti, I'll come to you now. How do you view the year gone by in terms of the Prime Minister's visits abroad, beginning the year with Bhutan, now capping it up with China, Mongolia and South Korea?
You know what just now Mr. Seshadri-Chari said, I would say it in a little different way on one different aspect. You know, actually there was a lot overdue to be done in foreign policy of India. Because I will, at the risk of being repetitive, there was policy paralysis, and more than that, there was a total blackout. We were living in a state of affairs where Indian government appeared to be not at all worried about whatever is going around in the world, the way we were treated. You know, even he mentioned Bhutan. You know, the way, if you remember, one of our BS officers was killed by in Bangladesh, and the way they brought his dead body handed over, it was a national humiliation, and being done by Bangladesh, you know, which we otherwise should have been our very close friend. The way in Nepal, the way our even diplomatic staff were treated, humiliated on more than one occasions. The problem is the vacuum which was created during last 10 years, especially during the UPA rule, was very unfortunate. The reason perhaps was, you see, just the other opposite today. We had a Prime Minister who had practically no opinion. We had a Prime Minister who, for every decision, who had to go to 10 Janpat to take direction and instructions. And today you see that something or earthquake happening in Nepal, and Indian Prime Minister is the first to inform the Nepalese Prime Minister about this. This is not something small. Indian Prime Minister within few minutes takes a decision. Your team, rescue teams are dispatched, of course, with consent of the Nepalese leaders. And you know, you have a Prime Minister who is proactive, who takes decisions very fast. And because there was a lot pending, a lot to be done, so to fill that vacuum, somebody had to do a lot of work. So I am not surprised, rather I am appreciative that Prime Minister Modi tried to fill that gap.
Okay.
And even if he had to, you know, at the risk of you know, leaving behind so many other things which were also important at home, he traveled to all those places which were important for India's interests. And this I think the Congress leader, who was very contemptuous about his foreign visits, he should have shown the wisdom that whatever his party could not do, his Prime Minister could not do, this Prime Minister is doing, and he should have been thankful and appreciative of Mr. Modi.
Okay, so you're saying that this 1 year has In this 1 year, the Prime Minister has given a lot of attention to the nations that were not getting the attention.
Yes,
they
it was overdue.
We
are happy that he has done.
All right, let me go across to Professor Gopal Arora now. He's the Secretary of Indian Council for International Cooperation. Welcome to the program, Professor Arora. We are talking about the Prime Minister's international visits in the past 1 year. 18 countries, 365 days. How do you view the year gone by, starting from Bhutan to ending it with South Korea?
I will be concentrating more on the diaspora issue of his foreign policy. I think one of the key achievements of Prime Minister Modi has been his engagement with the diaspora. If I take you back to a little historical perspective, engagement with Indian diaspora was not really forming the core of our foreign policy. But look at the countries which Prime Minister has visited. He has been to Mauritius, he has been to Seychelles, he has been to Fiji. In fact, even before he assumed office, he was very clear in his mind that diaspora, you see, will be an important area of his foreign policy. As I told you that it was only in the NDA 1 under the Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee that diaspora assumed a significance when the high level committee was formed under the chairmanship of late LM Singhviji, of which veteran journalist and activist Baleshwar Agrawal, Hire Murji, R.L. Bhatiaji were the members. So it was only at that time when you really had an institutionalized engagement with the diaspora through the celebration of Pravasi Bharatiya Divas and Ministry of Overseas Indian Affairs was formed. So we at Indian Council for International Cooperation, which has been working for the past more than 35 years with the Indian diaspora, we are satisfied and we look at it in a very, very positive manner, because our diaspora is not only very diverse, it is geographically also diverse. We have a PIO segment, we have NRI segment, and I think Prime Minister is doing a wonderful job in engaging with all segments of diaspora across the globe.
Right,
and
Professor
this
Arora,
will pay a such dividend in the future.
Right. I'll come back to that point of the Prime Minister's engagement with the Indian diaspora in just a moment. We have to slip into a break right now. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Insight. We are talking about the Prime Minister's foreign visits in the past 1 year and how they have contributed to cementing our ties with the countries across the world. We'll continue the discussion with Professor Gopal Arora. Professor Arora, if we talk about how the Prime Minister has engaged with the diaspora, taking forward the point that you mentioned earlier in the program, the way he was received in New York at the Madison Square Garden address, it has almost become like a template for all his NRI programs, and it's been repeated elsewhere as well, in Australia, be it Canada, Germany, China, or for that matter, even countries like Myanmar. What does it say about the way he has galvanized our diaspora outside?
Actually, I think he has been able to really strike a direct connection, an emotional connect with the diaspora. As I was telling you that, even before he assumed office, in an interview he said that, we are with our diaspora, we are proud of our diaspora, and in case diaspora feels any problem, then we should be there to help them. So that has really gone down very well with it. In fact, I find that his support base outside India has really increased a lot, and people look at him very positively. And he has been able to convince them to get involved with the social projects of India, like Namami Gange, Swachh Bharat also. People really feel that he is making sense. And I am of the opinion that this will eventually help us in getting investments also from the diaspora as the economic scenario improves in India.
I would like to add one more point to this. You know, I have, as a journalist, I have experience traveling abroad and meeting Indians and the way they used to be treated by their own embassies across the world. Mm-hmm. It was a very unfortunate situation. I worked in Germany with a radio station for a few years, and moving across Europe, I was shocked to note, and it happened 30 years ago, that the Indians living abroad were not treated nicely by their own, by our own embassies. Mm-hmm. When they were in trouble, there was hardly any support coming to them. Rather, they were condemned if they were caught somewhere for some reason, rather than getting support. And secondly, the unfortunately, the diplomatic staff in most of our embassies were more engaged in their own protocols, their own comforts. Mr. Modi has changed everything. You know, the way he has instructed the diplomatic missions to behave, the way the facilities he has extended, visa facilities and other things to the diaspora, and the interaction with the with these communities he has established, you know, that has changed the overall dimension of our approach towards diaspora and the diaspora's approach towards India.
Okay.
We, you know, practically he has converted a liability, you know, I put in quote, because those people were treated as the liability. He has converted them into asset, a political asset, a financial asset, a cultural asset for India. I think that is a remarkable change which should be appreciated.
Right.
You know, I would like to take the point that Mr. Gopal Arora has made as far as involving and engaging with the diaspora. You know, there are two aspects of it, NRI and PIO. You know, we should be able to differentiate between the NRI community and the PIO community. Non-resident Indians are basically an economic concept. People who go out, work, come back. They earn, and we want a share of their earnings here. So they were the ones who gave us the foreign currency, which was much needed. But their engagement ended there. People of Indian origin are people who left India, say about 200, 300, 400 years back, and who have settled in foreign countries, and they have contributed towards the social and economic welfare and even political welfare of the countries of their adoption. So they are there in their countries of adoption, and at the same time they are deeply rooted to the countries of their origin. So they have a cultural link, they have an economic link, they have a political link in the country of their adoption.
Absolutely.
And that is why I remember during NDA 1, during the regime of Atal Bihari Vajpayee, there was a PIO parliamentarian conference in which more than 80, 90 people, Mr. Gopal Arora would probably be able to give us the numbers. So many number of foreign PIO, people of Indian origin who hold political post in the countries of their adoption had come here. So even now if you look at it, the diaspora community in the US is inching towards political participation in that country. And you look at Canada, you look at UK, you look at Germany, you look at Myanmar, you look at Sri Lanka, all these countries, Fiji for example, they all have a huge diaspora bank which is very active not only in the social and economic activities of their countries of adoption but also the political activity in those countries. So imagine the kind of goodwill that we will be building with these countries.
Absolutely.
Not just the diaspora but with these countries per se. So this is a huge investment that we are supposed to have made in the last 20, 30 years. But now with Narendra Modi addressing that particular issue, this issue has really caught the imagination of not only our country but also these countries. There are more than 80 to 90 countries which are very strong in Indian diaspora. And most importantly, this is what China has been doing for the last 30 years. Biggest contribution towards China's income as far as the foreign income is concerned, foreign currency is concerned, comes from the Chinese diaspora. So they are very strong. They are very strong in these countries.
Professor Arora, what do you have to say about that? You know, taking our engagement with the Indian diaspora beyond just the remittances that the NRIs have been contributing to the Indian economy and taking it to another level. Some of them, as Mr. Chari pointed out, also have a political voice in their in the countries that they have adopted.
I think Mr. Chari has very aptly put it that our diaspora policy in the earlier times was not really a holistic policy. We were concentrating too much on NRI, and that also a specific segment of NRI. But with Mr. Modi, not only it has been a holistic policy. One more thing which I wanted to add was that he has actually struck a very good connect with the diaspora youth. Mm-hmm. You see, at the Pravasi Bharatiya Devas, he made wonderful suggestions about connecting with the youth. He said that we should have, online quiz programs with the diaspora youth. You see, that is a very important segment. Mm-hmm. If we lose our connect with the youth, then we'll be eventually losing out our connect with that PIO segment also. Hmm. So that is also very important. So he has been able to strike a good connect with the diaspora youth also. Look at the programs which we have now, like No India program. Every year, you see, the ministry invites 3-4 batches of diaspora youth, take them around India, tell them about India. And I'll tell you, since we have been engaging with the youth which come to India under the No India program, so when we take their feedback, we ask them, what was your opinion about India, when you were to come to India, and now that you have completed that No India program, what is your impression about India? There's a sea change. So it is very, very important to have a good connect and engagement with the diaspora youth also.
Okay.
Otherwise, they will have a perception of India which is far away from reality. So that kind of program also, needs to be augmented further, and that can pay us good dividend in future.
Okay, Mr. Vijay Kranti, a quick word on the perception part that
yes.
Professor Arora mentioned. The Prime Minister, during his visit to South Korea, also said that the perception is changing now, and NRIs want to come back to India.
There is a qualitative change.
Mm-hmm.
I was just now talking about my working abroad 30 years ago.
Mm.
Those days, unfortunately, the Indian passport was not a very, very respected document. But now you see things are changing. Things have changed drastically.
Hmm.
And perception of the world about India is changing.
Mm-hmm.
And especially with coming of Mr. Modi and with his style of functioning, with his outreach to the world and the way he has connected with the best of powers and presented India in a very respectable manner.
Hmm.
That is changing. The perception now is very, very different which used to be.
Hmm.
So there, as an Indian, I feel very happy.
Okay.
I feel very proud.
Hmm.
And especially now that Mr. Modi, the way he has started presenting India in its new role.
All right.
That is something very encouraging.
Okay. All right. With that, we slip into yet another break in the program. Stay with us. We'll be right back.